At the risk of stating the obvious, compliance can be hard. It's really tough to move fast and maintain a competitive edge while still taking into account all the necessary fail-safes and standards imposed by third parties, whether those are regulatory bodies or internal or external customers. To manage that, you need consistency and automation. And to achieve that, you need some sort of infrastructure as code. Architecturally, there are a lot of different ways to approach that, and our speakers today have tried several of them. Yannis Dienst and Jan Kolas from DB Systel had to build a multi-tenant infrastructure that met both internal standards for process separation and external ISO 20000 service management requirements. And they did so by leveraging a couple of different architectures built on GitLab. So let's have a listen and see what they learned.
Hello and welcome to our talk. We are here from Germany and I'm joined by my colleague Jan Kolas. I'm Johannes Dienst and we are sharing the journey from managed cloud to GitOps, a journey we had over the last 2 years in our team, and we want to deploy several client clusters per customer in AWS and how it all started and how it's going and how we and where we are now. We are sharing in this talk today. So let's give some context. Where are we coming from? We are both employees in the same team at DB Systel. DB Systel is a subsidiary of Deutsche Bahn, the main German railway and logistics provider in Germany. We are operating worldwide with over 300,000 employees, and DB Systel is driving the digitalization of Deutsche Bahn in every aspect and in servitization. And what we're doing specifically and how and why it's important that we're deploying several client clusters in the cloud, we will share in the next screen. And I give over to Jan.
Thank you. Yeah, we are running and building the DB Content Hub, and it's in detail. It's a headless content management system. We are providing it as a content as a service in the whole firm, and in basically it's running on a whole infrastructure cluster. So it consists of several servers running on Linux, running our actual software, of course, running different other applications as Nginx as a reverse proxy and so on. More for that later. And of course, we are using the central services of the AWS cloud as the RDS, Relational Database Service, the Elasticsearch service, and so on. Yeah, and in front of all the customer clusters, we are also running a centralized API to lighten the data access, to control the request traffic, and so on. And of course, to count the traffic because it's a small part of our business model. Yeah, and the main requirement of this whole infrastructure was due to data privacy protection, was to really separate each cluster from the other, because we definitely were not allowed, or it was definitely not allowed that the data of one customer cluster could reach the data of the other customer cluster. We had to ensure this. Therefore, we built this infrastructure we will present to you. And more to that in a few minutes. And in front of it, as I said, is the central API. It implements, of course, a routing mechanism based on an API key per customer. So it interprets the key and routes the traffic to the correct cluster or to the correct load balancer in the background.
And the data privacy protection was not the only requirement you had to fulfill. Deutsche Bahn is a big company. I always call it a corporate environment. In a corporate environment, there's a lot of certification, specification, and requirements and constraints. And one specific constraint is the ISO 20000. And this is an overview of the ISO 20000, and we are focusing specifically on the service management system requirements. So I can talk a few hours about ISO 20000, but we won't do that here because you want to learn something about infrastructure as code, for example, and how we use it with GitLab. So the main things I want to talk about in short are the change management and release management, and there are specific requirements to change management and release management if you are ISO 20000 certificate. certified. And one requirement, for example, is which is easily implemented with a version control system like GitLab, is you need to have a request for change if you want something to get into production. And this is a merge request or a pull request. How you call it is not important. But there are also other requirements. For example, you have to have release notes. And release notes, I remember doing it a few years earlier, manually jotting down the commits, what got changed in the software. And with automation and pipelining, you can automate release notes to a high degree or even 100%. What also is important in the process of ISO 20000, and which is common sense, but also best practice, is testing. And this is also aided by pipelines. You can automatically test specific tests and automate all the tests if you're willing to do it. What we also have a requirement, and this I don't think it's very specific to ISO 20000, but I want to mention it here. We have to plan every change or every release in a centralized tool. So every interface partner we have or every other team which uses our software knows about the change which is potentially breaking or interrupts the service. And you can put this in a pipeline too if you're able to automate and put everything into Git, for example. So from the requirements to our first try and our first customer, because the speciality of our team is we are not building a project, but we're building a product which is sold to many customers. And our first try was, well, the first customer where we said, okay, we have a managed cloud and we want to deploy something into this managed cloud. And what we did there was putting Ansible playbooks in a Git repository, which is cool because then a developer from our team can check out a Git repository and deploy the software to or the infrastructure, the configuration of the infrastructure specifically to the servers. Because managed cloud also always means there's less automatization potential and you have to buy or configure the infrastructure beforehand a little bit and say, okay, we have a relation database, for example, and an EC2 instance if you're in AWS. And then you check out the Git repository, as we did here on our local laptop, and configured the provisioned infrastructure there. And there's one big downside of that. It's convenient, but the big downside is you can't be sure that the provisioning of the infrastructure or the configuration of the infrastructure is the same as in the Git repository. What you do want is that the configuration in the Git repository is the truth and is identical to the configuration on the server. And one anecdote I want to share with you is that we had a plugin for our board software there, and it turned out that the configuration of the plugin or the implementation of the plugin wasn't the same as in the Git repository. In fact, the one who deployed it changed it on locally on his computer, and we didn't know what he changed because it wasn't in the Git. So we had to re-implement it to match the requirement when we updated the plugin. So this was very tedious. And there's also this compliance problem. If you can't be sure what is on the server, then you're not compliant. You can't say what what's the truth, and that's a big problem in our company. So if we gain more customers and not just one, we have three here, and actually there were three, we said, okay, that's not possible to provision the servers beforehand and then configure them. We said, okay, we have to move to AWS to be have a more cloudy approach. And the cloudy approach means, okay, we provision our software from our Git repository. And in fact, what we did when we went to AWS, we used AWS CloudFormation and put all the user customer configuration into the Git repository. So there were three configuration directories and the CloudFormation template. This has not the problem with the compliance anymore, because when you deploy over a pipeline and only deploy over a pipeline to the different customer clusters, then you are automatically compliant. Only if someone goes into production and changes by hand, but that's not recommended. So the compliance is easy to achieve, and the infrastructure is verifiable over code. So truth in the repository matches the truth in the cloud. And this is very powerful. One big disadvantage we noticed with a monorepo for though was that somehow we were able to change the wrong customer configuration, because the customer configuration was structured all the same way. Only the directory name was different. And if you change the, if you're somehow under stress or have to change something into in a hurry, then you were able to change the wrong customer and deploy it into production, which was not so fun. And that's the reason why we said, okay, it's doable that way, but it's hard to maintain. So we said, okay, we need a different approach, which I give over to Jan. He will explain it in more detail.
Yeah, this is our third try and hopefully the final approach we are doing here. It's a combination of Terraform and GitLab, GitOps, Git in general. Terraform is a description or descriptive language for infrastructure in the cloud. Let it be Azure. In our cloud, it's in our case, it's the AWS cloud. So in our case, we have several assets we are maintaining, developing, and enhancing. For example, as I said, the different Docker containers, the Nginx Docker container, our actual software, the Headless Content Management System, is also bundled in a Docker container, and all the Docker containers are running on the Linux instances. Of course, our infrastructure description itself is an asset, and all our assets are versionized. Yeah, later, more for that. We have several other assets as our plugins we develop for the CMS system, or of course the AMIs, the Amazon Machine Images, which are representation of the later Linux operating system running on the servers. So when we develop or enhance a Docker container, for example, the container gets built by a pipeline. And when the build is successful, it gets uploaded into the internal registry we are using. It's JFrog Artifactory. And after that, the change, the new version, is propagated in a central repository per customer. So we have one repository per customer, which covers basically a configuration of the later infrastructure, which gets deployed into the AWS cloud. Now the new version of this Docker container, or the new version of the infrastructure description, the new version of the AMI, gets a merge request is created in the customer's repository. This merge request is automatically accepted, and the new version is merged into the configuration file of this customer. It's just a simple JSON file. So now, when we want to deploy a new customer cluster or new customer infrastructure, we just trigger a job or a pipeline in this customer repository. The job, which is responsible for that, takes the configuration file and translates it into GitLab variables and calls the infrastructure repository and passes the configuration as GitLab variables into this infrastructure pipeline. In this job that is triggered in the infrastructure pipeline, the GitLab variables are also passed into the Terraform description of the later infrastructure. And using this, we can configure things like the AMI image, the AMI, the Docker container, but also things like how many nodes should be there in the Elasticsearch cluster, or which instance, which database instance we want to use in the relational database service of AWS. Yeah, and afterwards, just the infrastructure pipeline runs, executes the whole Terraform stack, and the whole infrastructure is built or updated in the AWS cloud. And that is basically the whole magic behind our approach. One side note is we are not allowed to use, unfortunately, to use GitLab variables for secrets and so on. So we have set up our own secret management. Also, we are using Mozilla SOPS to encrypt the files covering all our secrets. These files are then automatically decrypted in a pipeline and stored in the AWS Secrets Manager. All this, one note, all this is possible because our GitLab runners have permission to access, our account in the AWS cloud. Otherwise, this approach were not possible. Yeah, and this, with this approach, the secrets are stored in the Secrets Manager, and when the Linux instances comes up, in Amazon language, it's called Cloud Init. The server is started, and this in this Cloud Init script, the secrets are taken from the secrets manager and passed into the Docker containers, perhaps to get access to the database, to get access to the Elasticsearch service, and so on. Okay. And a very important concept behind this for us is the Git flow approach. For now, we are using three branches to develop. So when we enhance or change a Docker container, maybe the Nginx Docker container, we create a feature branch, do some coding, whatever, change a Docker file. Then the usual review process is done. And if everything is fine, this feature branch is merged into the development branch. Now the build pipeline for the Docker container runs, it gets uploaded into Artifactory, and a new version of this container is created. This new version is propagated into the customer's repository. And in the customer repository, we have the same structure of these branches. So this new version gets merged into the configuration file in the development branch of the customer. And what we can do now is each branch is a representation of an environment in the AWS cloud. So we are able to create a cluster, a testing cluster, a development cluster for this customer. Or we are able to create a staging, in our case, it's a staging environment in the AWS or production environment. We could enhance it with as many branches as we need. For now, these three branches are enough for us. So when we did our tests in the development environment, everything is cool. We merge the Docker container into the main branch. The same process starts from the beginning. The main version is merged into the customer repository. Now we can pre-test for the production this Docker container on the staging environment. And if really everything is fine on Monday 10 a.m., we push the button and deploy everything on the production environment of this customer. Now here you can see a real life example of this pipelines. On the top left, you can see how we trigger this customer pipeline. In this case, we triggered a development environment in the AWS cloud. So we pushed this button. Afterwards, the infrastructure repository gets called, or the infrastructure pipeline. One side note here, we have two AWS accounts, one for testing purposes. This is where the development environment is created, and one production account where we create the production clusters of the customer, the staging environment, and the production environment. In this case, the development pipeline is triggered, and one click later, you see the Terraform representation of the Terraform pipeline. One click, Johannes. Thank you. Everything's good. And in Terraform, you do several steps. At first, you first validate your Terraform description. Is everything fine? Can we build this infrastructure? And the second step is you plan what has to be done to create this infrastructure. And finally, the whole stuff is applied, in our case, to the AWS cloud. We first create the environment of our main application because, as you know, the application needs a running database, needs the Elasticsearch service, and so on. So we first apply the network storage in AWS. This is the Elastic File System. It's attached to each server running our software. The database is created, as I said, the relational database service and the Elasticsearch service. And afterwards, our service setup is really deployed and really created and starts up.
Okay, we're already nearly at the end, so let's wrap it up. What we learned today, we had the requirements of ISO 20000 and also the data privacy protection requirements from the EU, but also from Deutsche Bahn, where we say, okay, no customer thread should be able to get data from another thread. So a real multi-tenant system we had to build there. And we had to implement the change management, release management. As you could see, hopefully, we are able to do this, except for configuration as code because of a customer repository where we store the configuration, but also with a GitLab flow that we can do release management and change management very easily. But that's not the only advantages we got from this approach with Terraform and the configuration as code for each customer. We also got a few more advantages, and I give the word to Jan once more, and we will go over them one by one.
Thank you. Yeah, for using our current approach, it's very, very easy to create or to set up new customer stacks. In ancient times, it was really, really hard because we had to do several things by hand and manually, and it takes time. The more customers you got, the more time it takes, of course. And now we can just create a simple repository. We have scripts to initialize this new customer repository, and then we can just push a button and create the whole production cluster of this customer. And of course, your turn.
Yeah, I would do the next. So yeah. What we also have, and this is especially important for me, Jan came a little bit later, so he doesn't know these ancient times. He only knows it from my history and explanation. But I really find it interesting and very satisfying to have rolling updates now, if we don't changing the relation database, of course, because this needs a downtime. We are not doing anything by hand. We just say, okay, pipeline run with a new configuration and a new infrastructure configuration, and it just rolls into production without any problem. And this is made possible by the pipeline approach we had chosen. Yep. So.
And of course, there are several other things we could talk about here. And one thing is we have an own monitoring stack consisting of Prometheus, Grafana, Elasticsearch, Kibana, and so on. And every machine, every server that comes up automatically recognizes itself in this monitoring system. And this is also possible because of this automatic approach. We can also deploy new dashboards automatically into Grafana. We can export the metrics of the Linux system, the CPU load, and so on into Prometheus. And that's a cool feature that helps us very, very, very much. Yeah.
And the last one to emphasize the compliance and security approach with GitLab pipelines or pipelines in general, it's very easy. And it's very easy with GitLab, especially because it's a containerized build. We can add stages for compliance checks and update security updates very easily. If we need a new tool, for example, open source license checking, we insert a new stage. And this is usually just one little block and a little bit of configuration. So we are easily compliant in that regard. And if there are security updates with the rolling updates, we are having no problem deploying them in under one day.
Yeah, and very fast, yeah. Cool.
So that's it for our talk. I hope you got something out of it. I'm pretty sure it's a little bit high level because of the short time. We could talk about it much, much longer, I think, if we go into detail. But we are there for question and answer, so you can ask two questions or more if you like. If you want to reach us, there are our business emails. I'm also reachable at Twitter. There's a Twitter handle. So thank you and have a nice day.
Thank you.